John's working on a unicorn farm.
It's gonna be awesome.
Ty's got a body double. He's been going to parties instead.
They're completely missing the point. If someone doesn't want to pay a penny for this thing to be played,
yeah,
like, come on, man. I'm sorry, you can't have my fucking songs. Like, that should be the conversation, but nobody's having it. It's such a fucking pittance.
This is the Cameron Adair podcast with me, Cameron Adair. This is episode 3. Today on the show is Matt Jones. Matt runs Castle Face Records. We met up in a rooftop room of an apartment in Alamo Square in San Francisco with some weed plants. We talked about synthesizers, the San Francisco exodus, vinyl manufacturing, and running a record label. Here's Matt.
Here we go.
What happened to your check? What happened to your amp?
I was carrying an amp and getting off stage with the heavy amp. And I slipped in some beer when I stepped off the stage and like flew forward and like crushed my pinky. So I just had surgery like a week ago, and they fused these two bones together because I busted this bone all up and tore the tendon and stuff.
You bend it back?
No, it was more like this.
Just
it was like jammed, but it was like it broke a big chunk of this bone off.
Ow.
It was pretty fucked up. So, yeah, surgery, blast.
Did they put like pins in it?
Yeah, you can see the pins.
Ooh. No joke.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. How's your day going? You're up here for a show at the Hemlock?
Yeah, and we did this thing for Pressure Drop TV. Have you heard of those guys?
No.
They record bands playing live in like a bunch of different environments. And they recorded us playing at KUSF in Exile, which is like out in Bayview, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
It's like by Secret Studios. I think it's one of the Secret Studios studios.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was cool. Yeah, and then we're playing tomorrow at the Hemlock. And I get a chance to see Total Control. I was only going to see him tonight, but I got a chance to see him last night at the Knockout, so I went to that. They were fucking awesome.
Yeah.
They were really good.
Yeah, it's nice to go to smaller shows while like Outside Lands is happening. That's
totally.
What I
was, that, is that what's
then
going
it's just
on?
Super chill. Yeah. That's what I did on Friday.
Did you enjoy
last
it?
Last Friday. Yeah, it was super chill. It was like a little more, I don't know. It's like having the theme park to yourself.
Yeah,
so everyone's.
It's like the week of Burning Man. San Francisco's always way nicer.
Yeah,
you're like, what? There's suddenly parking.
So, what? So you kind of moved quietly down to LA.
Yeah,
with your girlfriend, who I've known for a long, long time, since like high school.
Yeah, well, we did break up.
Oh,
recently.
Sorry to bring that up.
It's okay. It's just more in my cosmic bad luck, sort of.
Yeah. Really? Is that a recent thing or?
Yeah, it's been a couple of weeks.
The cosmic bad luck?
It's been a couple of weeks. It's fine. She's a great girl. I'm not upset about.
A lot of times moving will do that.
Yeah, and it's super stressful and you're like living together. And if you don't know a bunch of people, I mean, we knew plenty of people down there. So it's not even that. It's more just, I don't know. Grow apart. But anyway. So yeah, I've had a bunch of fun life changes lately.
Yeah. And a lot of people I know have.
Yeah.
So
you gotta just keep on trucking, man. Like, I don't know. I think it'll probably be good for me to be alone for a while because I just have a gazillion things going on, you know? Just trying to stay focused on that. I don't know. Sometimes, like, you define your, a lot of, it's easy to define your life by, like, who you're in love with, right?
Yeah.
So, I don't know. Maybe it's time for me not to be in love with anybody. That's a shrug.
Yeah.
It's an inaudible shrug. Inaudible, just, handicapped shrug.
I'm just trying to think about that for a second. But, yeah. I mean, it's, I don't know.
I'm all out of love.
Yeah.
Just for the moment.
Yeah. So, it can be hard, especially if you're like the type of person who is like doing shit yourself.
Yeah.
And you're not like going to the office every day or sitting in your cubicle, sort of sitting in traffic sort of person, which makes focusing on a domestic achievements a little bit more natural.
Yeah. Well, into like when you work from home, then the personal space in the home becomes smaller, you know, because it's like if I'm doing the work, like I'm literally like ignore everything else around me and let fucking dishes pile up or whatever, like until I'm done, and that kind of like mentally switch gears. Everybody's different with how they handle that, but like, you know, just being in a space. A kind of smallish space in which you're also working. It's like it's tough to draw those lines. And also, too, you know, I don't know, whatever.
Yeah.
It's
I was living on my own for a long time in the same place that I worked.
Yeah.
And, you know, just over 400 square feet, which is.
Yeah, I know. I know exactly how big that is.
Yeah, so. Well, for a long time in San Francisco, that was the minimum size requirement for build out. So a lot of the old
that's the one they built. They built a bunch of them.
So that's a familiar.
I should probably point this more into this.
Yeah, you could actually scoot that up too if you want. You could like
more like this.
Unhook it.
Dr. Fraser Crane.
But my girlfriend really hates because if I'm in this, you know, working and I won't pick up the phone for days at a time sometimes. So
sometimes you gotta do that.
Well,
on that cheery note,
it's really nice up here. We're like by Alamo Square and
just doing a little quick thing, man. Yeah.
And we're in like a little rooftop house that's all two sides are windows, and I can see, I think, I don't know, is that Bernal right there?
I can see like hills in Oakland from over here.
Mount and Diablo.
Then, yeah, Bernal's over there, and this is the Castro kind of over there, and like Diamond Heights.
That's Hollywood over there.
Twin Peaks. We've got Ukrainian Village. I don't know.
All right. So, how's what happened to your old band?
Blasted Canyons?
Yeah, Blasted Canyons. I was just talking to my friend who's a good friend of mine. He was talking. He said to maybe ask you about that. And when you guys switched gears, if it's coming back up or if you're just doing the new male gaze stuff.
Blasted Canyons, kind of the idea was like synth, guitar, drums. And we all would trade off because we could all sing and all kind of play everything. So it was like kind of, that was like the fun, the sort of setup for the band was like rotating chairs. Everybody gets to play drums. Everybody gets to play synth.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas like male gaze is like, was kind of more like, I wanted to have like a really simple to play band where you're just like, just give us guitars and a bass and drums or whatever. And then you kind of do it wherever. It had been a while since I'd really like focused on guitar. Funny enough now that I can't play it, but you know, like,
yeah, I like been, Tony Iommi over there.
It's Django, man, with the two fingers. That's the only guy I know that can do it with two.
Or Jerry Garcia.
Yeah, he lost the middle one. Yeah.
Or who's the drummer from Def Leppard with one arm?
Yeah, I can't remember his name.
Or
I'm a famous drummer, lost me arm.
Wesley Isold, the Cold Cave guy.
Oh yeah,
there's a whole tradition of this. You need to step. You know, this is a whole new thing. This is opening doors for you.
I like to think with any sort of setback, at least you learn something. So I've been like learning how to kind of do other shit. I mean, I've just been playing like one-handed keyboard a bunch, and that's been really fun. But in a way, it kind of like brings the poles closer together, because what Male Gaze initially was and what Blasted Canyons initially were, like with the synth as part of it, you know. I've always believed in the synthesizer as like a rock and roll instrument, you know.
Yeah.
But it's also really tough to carry around a bunch of cool old shit that gets broken really easily and it has difficult to replace parts. And this shit gets stolen, you know. I'm like, it was a big stressor, especially Blasted Canyons. We carried around like an 80-pound fucking huge keyboard. You know, the larger of the two keyboards, the Oberheim is massive.
It's an OB-8 or something?
Yeah, the OB-8.
That's so popular.
It's incredible. And I mean, they're really expensive synths now. I got it a long time ago, but it's a really super expressive, very sophisticated instrument that we were like thrashing around to play like one fucking note on. You know what I mean? It's like unison. And it's like, I mean, you could like you could write Police albums with it.
Yeah.
It had a really like very specific type of like, or Eurythmics, like that Sweet Dreams is like Oberheim fucking string sound, like that shit.
Yeah.
So, shit is really cool. And we were like kind of underutilizing it anyway. It would have been smart to change it up synth wise to more portable shit, which this time with the Male Gaze, now that I'm playing these shows like this, I'm using the new ARP Odyssey, which is out of this world. It's really cool.
Oh yeah, the re-release one. Yeah, that's so awesome that they're doing that.
Incredible.
I got
$1,000. It's like the best. I think it's the best synth on the market. It's like really easy to play. It's really easy to play like simple shit, but good shit, and like very expressive, tons of control, and they're really cool looking.
Yeah,
it's rad.
Yeah, I've been through a lot of synths. Like I got out of it when I started getting really serious into the guitar.
Yeah.
And, that's super fun stuff.
You buy one synth, man. It's like a classic like synth type too, like the monophonic. The thing is like the monophonic, like you're figuring it all out, totally manual synth makes so much sense for bands. And then like the early ones that you can program stuff into, it's like you get too many options. It's not like really good to have in a band, but like that era of synths is great because it's mostly just for leads. It just cuts right through. It's super awesome. You can do two notes if you want to. And then like the Junos, you know, it's when you could kind of like, you're like, I've got a set, and it's like every song's got a kind of a different sound. But even that, it's like it starts getting a little too complex, and it's, they jump the shark eventually, you know.
You have to like just recalling like too many patches, you just start feeling like you're...
I mean, I was like messing around over at Engine Works with Seth from Useless Eaters, because we were talking about MIDI, and like his girl has this drum machine, and we were like trying to sync it up with his microcorgs. And the thing is that the
microcorg... CV converter, like a Kenton converter.
No, it's got MIDI. It's got MIDI. So it's like, you know, just like sending the MIDI and like having it pick that up. It's like all these really stupid like sub menus and stuff. It's just like, it's cool. I mean, I like that they were able to fit so much into this thing, but...
So you have the Juno 80 or the Juno 106? Because I've had a couple...
106. It's the 60 you're thinking of.
Oh, the 60, right.
The 60, and the 106. I've had the 106 for a really long time. Mine's kind of fucked up. It's been like a couple years that the last note that you play just gets like stuck on in this really like buzzy sort of like 30% volume sort of way. It's shitty. They are great and really versatile, and like it's kind of like it was my first synth, but I mean that's kind of like what they are. Or what they're good for, I think, because it teaches you like all the principles of this stuff, and you can see how it's utilized. And there's like a bunch of different programs that are like that, but then you can go in and like, you know what I mean? It's like really basic, really like clearly set.
What's
up.
Cool is that you can program the sliders with SysX messages, so you can get like you can just
a bunch
do it
of the
all.
Sliders. Yeah, I mean, I don't know about all of them, but there's definitely a good couple of them, and it eats up your MIDI memory, but you know, whatever. But yeah, the Juno's a beautiful thing. I've played around with the 60, and I know people really like the 60 a lot.
What about the MKS 80? I think if I had my choice, I've never even used one, But that's like the rack mount one. That's like five Jupiters in one. Shit. And then you can get like the little controller that comes separate.
Out of control.
Yeah. You
start carrying around rack mount shit to gigs and you may as well just like kiss your social life goodbye. You're just like, dude, you brought like a rolling rack mount gig thing. What are you doing?
Yeah.
And they're so heavy and fucking hard to move around. It's like those are designed to sit in one place, which is cool.
The studio
is cool. One of my favorite things to do is just take down all the keyboards, rearrange, put them up again in another way.
It's like zen.
It is very zen.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like I said, I stopped getting into it, but I saw that they like were re-releasing like the MS-20 and all this stuff, which is
cool. The MS-20 is awesome too.
I used to have
I was in fucking line for that.
I was in college. Oh, really?
Yeah. I like bought it. I was up at my buddy's place in Portland and we went to this place, Control Voltage, pretty awesome store, and you can like play all the shit, and I was playing and I was like, this is incredible. I'll buy it right now. And they're like, well, you know, they're only made a couple. So like we got like a, you know, waiting list. I waited like 3 months for it. It was awesome though. I was totally stoked. $600. It's incredible.
When I bought my original one a long time ago.
You had an original MS-20?
Yeah.
Sick.
And it was like $800 off eBay.
That's awesome. Those days are done, man.
Yeah, that's what I figured. I don't look anymore. I know if I look, I'll just
cry.
So it'll just fuck my mind up, and then I'll want one, and then I gotta.
You'll want it worse.
Yeah,
I remember. Yeah, I don't know. I've always been such a fucking gear freak, and anytime I can like grab something like that, that's like a good price. It's like,
yeah,
I'm like a hoarder. You'd be really surprised. I have like 20 fucking like all this shit. Like,
yeah,
the storage unit with like all sorts of gear in it. It's like I gotta cull the herd at some point. But I'm definitely a hoarder.
Have you been to the Vintage Synth Museum in Oakland?
No, I don't think I have. I just went to a new little shop. But you can't be talking about the same place.
What was the place you just said?
Waveformless.
Waveformless. Yeah,
that place is pretty cool.
There's like
I mean, everything's really expensive, but that's what you'd expect. But at least it's there. You can like look at the fucking thing. You know what I mean? Like, I think a lot of it's just like being able to check out how. I mean, everyone does kind of the same thing. Like a lot of synths do the same thing, or they do similar things. It's just like the implementation and how it all kind of comes together. You know. I really like sequential circuit stuff for that reason. I think that they have like really good like signal chains and
the new Dave Smith stuff is kind of falls a little short in my opinion.
I haven't played with much of that stuff. A buddy of mine has a Prophet 8, I think, which I've heard pretty good reviews on, more than like the Prophet 12. But I have a Prophet 600 that I think is a super expressive.
Oh, yeah, those are cool. Yeah, it's really cool. Yeah, that's a cool one because it's got like MIDI, right?
Yeah, it's got MIDI. It's got a bunch of patches. It's like Juno 106 era, but sequential. It's tight.
Yeah.
Yeah. Their shit's dope, man. They got into the stupid-ass submenus way early, though. Their submenus are terrible. Like, some people are just good at setting up menus and some people aren't.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, how long do you want to be fucking around with menus when you're trying to, like, come up with a sound, you know what I mean? Like I'm more of a knob guy.
Yeah.
So anyway.
Yeah, it's taking me back. No.
Yeah, okay, cool.
No, I mean, it's not really that kind of a show. I mean, I'm not, that sort of implies that I'm like looking for information, which I think is sometimes less entertaining.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what kind of information I can provide.
What's it like? What's it like in LA? I mean, I know John moved down there.
Yeah.
Ty moved down there.
Mm-hmm. And John's working on a unicorn farm. It's going to be awesome.
Cool. Where are they doing it? Oh.
On top of a hill. Now he bought a place. Ty bought a place. Like we've all been kind of like. I mean, yeah, I bought a place. We all use the same realtor, and we like complain about the realtor. That shit's pretty funny.
Oh yeah.
Well, not complain, but I mean, she's funny enough to where we all talk about her. We're like, what the hell? But it, she got the results, you know. Mm-hmm. They're like, Ty's got a body double. He's been going to parties instead. It's like, I don't know. It's been cool, man. And there's a bunch of good people down there. Like a bunch of, I've been meeting a lot of new people. It's nice. It's mellow. But I mean, for me, it's like, it's kind of at least a little bit of a double life because like, I don't know. I don't really go out a ton. I'm usually staying at home, kind of working, you know, like focusing on the stuff.
Yeah.
And then when I come up here, like I play some shows and like get drunk for a week or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, it's a lot easier to kind of like wander around and carouse because you can kind of walk, you know,
mm-hmm.
whereas, you know, you have to drive all the time. So it makes it harder to go get shit can wasted at the bar and end up home. Okay. You know?
Yeah, it's definitely a little more cozier.
The distances are greater, so it's a lot easier to stay at home.
So, like, what happened to sort of the whole thing when everyone moved away? Like, I've been sort of reticent to talk about like San Francisco hyper gentrification and
exodus.
Yeah, because it's kind of boring and it's hard to say anything new about it.
It's true.
Is that part of it? Or is it business stuff or what?
Yeah, it was kind of like all those things at once. Because like I knew, well, John was adamant about leaving and he had good reasons to leave and he talked about all that stuff. So I don't have to go back over that. But I don't know, man. I was at a time of life I wanted to buy a house. It's like not possible here. It makes it really realistic when you're like, oh, someone, I could get together three times as much money as I have. Like ask all my family to like get something together and to buy something and someone could swoop in and pay $1 million over the asking price in cash. Like that happened all the time.
Yeah.
That's just crazy. It's just discouraging. And then also like, I don't know, man, like San Francisco is a boom town, always has been from day one. It's been like boom and bust in different sort of industries and different sort of stuff, which is cool. But I think it's based on this like really wave cyclical like thing. I mean, you look back through since the, you know, when it was founded, it was like start out, you know, like with the Mormon colonists kind of like showing up and like setting up camp.
Yeah.
And then the gold rush was just like, oh, okay, let's throw a bunch of millionaires in here and see what the hell happens. And like, all, I mean, that was one of many multiple boom and busts here.
Yeah, but yeah. I kind of wonder if there's anything entirely unique about the most recent boom or bubble.
I think it's kind of unique in terms of scale, but also
some of the, you know, the tech fortunes are like some of the biggest fortunes like in history.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, these aren't like the corporations.
Adjusted for inflation even. They're
yeah.
incredible gains because, you know, you're putting all this automation stuff to work for you and all of a sudden you just like, you're just getting a rip without doing anything. You know what I mean? Once they set all that stuff up, a lot of it's just like, then it's just money adding up in bank accounts, you know? It's interesting, I have respect for the technical aspect of like making something that's so useful that millions of people pay for it, and like in a way, I appreciate like maybe what they're trying to do, but they definitely made this place impossible to live in. If you don't work all the time or you don't have some crazy deal, like it's cool. A lot of stuff is grandfathered in, and like when I got here, like. I was like, well, you just kind of have to like hang out and wait around and somehow some friend will help you like make it work. And it was always kind of like this like disbelief where you're like, I'm in this beautiful place and like somehow I found that like $800 a month apartment and I was just been there for 10 years. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, so that's where I was at.
That's where we're sitting. You know what I mean? So it's like, but it's tough, man. It's like a really
crazy hustle. Yeah, stop. Because I just want to put out that, you know, something you said that people make something useful that people are willing to pay for. I think a lot of that is just, I think the usefulness is in a lot of ways a sales pitch.
Yeah.
And it's not about usefulness. It's not about people. It's not about empowering people. It's about money.
Right. No, so. I'm not trying to dull anyone's fangs. They're still bloodthirsty vampires.
Yeah.
But you know, there's some aspects of like technological advancement that are pretty sweet. Like, you know, obviously what we're doing right now wouldn't be possible without a lot of this stuff. It's like, I think you do have to separate people actually doing it right. But it's, I don't know, the whole culture is so crazy. It's hard to get behind anything. But I mean, as far as like LA, yeah, it's a beautiful place. I feel like growing up here, like, everyone likes to talk shit on LA. And so I grew up thinking like, maybe LA kind of sucks. And it's like, it's so much nicer than anyone gives it credit for. I feel like it's actually pretty cool. It's a cool place. And like, I'm excited to, you know, get to know it more. Like, I'm not rushing into nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's been like a year. I still haven't met all my neighbors.
Yeah. I think it takes a couple of years to navigate a new place.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. And it's always nice to make a change. And like,
I get
for me, it was just like being able to be, I mean, John used to live down the street. So like when we kind of started out, it was like, all right, let's, you know, I'd just go over to his house and we'd meet and talk about all this stuff. And it was like easy. Then he moved to the Mission. So it was like a couple blocks away, but we were still like, you know, it was just like really simple. When he was talking about moving to LA, I was like, man, that's going to be a fucking hike. Like, I just thought it was a good idea. You know, you gotta like kind of focus on what's going well. And it's like, I was like, yeah, I think it's a good time. Let's just do this full time. It's a good idea. And being in proximity to that, you know, even just physically, because I mean, you know, we hang out a lot, it's barbecues and shit, and you know, we have a good time. But it's like there's always just a lot to discuss, you know.
So yeah,
it's good. It's good to have proximity.
So it was also a decision to be doing Castle Face full time,
mm-hmm.
and you know, invest in some real estate, whatever, et cetera.
Yeah,
just everything.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know,
not necessarily as much a push out.
Yeah, well, and I'd been saving up money, but I mean, the reality of like San Francisco was definitely, I mean, the writing's been on the wall for a second. Even if it wasn't like immediately super shitty, like it's been a really pretty rapid ramp. I mean, I come back here all the time. So I'm like watching it like maybe like a month, you know, a month or so goes by between each time. And like, it's crazy the rate of change here. It's just wild.
I don't even know where I am anymore, really. It feels like Palo Alto in the Mission.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not nice. But I mean, it's not really my place to, like, you know, who am I to say how this city should be? I mean, the other shoe's going to drop at some point, because a lot of this tech stuff is just like fairy tales. It seems like, you know, I think the unicorn like overinvestment bubble is going to leave some wreckage. So I don't know. It's just crazy, man. There's just too much money floating around. And I feel like that's the way San Francisco does it. You know, it's Barbary Coast. It's fucking Gold Rush. It's like this or that. You want to talk about like a hippie being fucking like suburban kids from all over the country just showing up and like.
Yeah.
I mean, that's where Charles Manson got his start. This fucking street preacher in right down the street, you know? So it's like, I think it's always like really crazy explosion of a bunch of shit and people just wanting to be here for weirdly different reasons. And to be able to hang on here is like, dude, I give a lot of respect to the lifers or people that have been here like 40 years. It's like, and it's an incredible amount of change like all the time. But I think that's just the spirit of the place. And it's like as much as you can survive. I mean, it's tough, dude. You got to be like a barnacle out here. You know, really fucking tough on that rock.
Yeah, that's true. it's kind of scary to see, you know, people I know like approaching their, you know, in their 40s.
Yeah.
Who
have no like job security or.
Yeah. All that stuff. It's like, so is that where I'm going by continuing to do this?
Well, and like, you know, we live in this weird economic bubble here too. I mean, San Francisco in the city itself is so much different than the region around it, even just in terms of like economics. It's just so much, it's really stratified, man. It's like,
yeah,
1920s level.
It's like ancient Egypt level stratified.
Yeah. It's not a good idea. You know, you're probably going to end up with like, you know, it just, people end up bearing the brunt of it. You know, you have more like theft and just random shit going on. If you, I don't know, man, it's crazy. Yeah. It's a wild place, man. It is always cool to come back. I was born here. It's on my birth certificate, you know.
So, oh, yeah?
Yeah. It will always be my hometown, but...
You grew up in Santa Rosa?
I did. Yeah.
Do you know Judah Nagler?
I do.
Oh, you do?
And his brother.
Nice.
Yeah, I know those guys. Yeah, they were
I
just...
I wanted to get him on, the
they're on
this
tour,
show.
Actually.
They're still going?
Yeah, they still go. They just put out.
I don't know why. I just thought because Santa Rosa.
Yeah,
and like
they're Santa Rosa's finest export. You know?
Yeah, finest export. Very nice. Yes.
Yeah.
Panda side.
Yeah, back in the day, and I think.
You were playing in bands at that time?
Yeah. It was early on, but yeah. It's cool. I like Santa Rosa. I mean, it was like the it was an interesting little scene there. It was nice to. It was nice to just move around, like do some different shit. So it was cool. But I've been really liking going back lately.
Yeah.
Check up with my buddies. You know?
I don't really know it up there, but I grew up in San Jose. And so any of the little things, whether it's like Gilman or...
Yeah. Yeah.
Coming here to see some of the bigger...
Up there was the Phoenix. You ever been there? The Phoenix Theater?
I haven't been there, no. I keep meaning to.
I really like Tom Gaffey. Like as a kid, I was like, dude, this guy just... like devoted his life to making an all ages theater for kids to like have scrappy first shows at.
Mm-hmm.
Like a huge stage. It was so much fun to be there as a kid, especially to play there. It was out of control. And this dude just like, I don't know, he just devoted his life to it. He was like an old taxi driver and he was just like, kids gotta have something to do. It's like awe inspiring. That guy rules.
What's the timeline of working at Pirates? Like how long were you living here? And
I was here for like 10 years. I worked for Pirates for like 10 years.
When? What year did you move?
Well, I was here like 2004. I started working for them in 2005. I was maybe in this place from like 2007. I don't know. It's all been like natural progressions, man. Everything's... slow, not necessarily definite.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like I've just been adjusting to what the time needs, you know, like or whatever's going on. Just trying to keep it going. Got a lot of irons in the fire with the label, so it's like yeah, it's a lot to look after. So I don't know. I just kinda like started putting more time into it, and I talked to Skip about it at Pirates Press, El Capitan.
Yeah, I saw some interview with him recently.
Yeah, he's the man.
Because they're doing my record right now.
Yeah.
And Carl's helped me out, and
Carl's a great guy too. Yeah,
he just moved out to Brooklyn.
Yeah, so. Yeah. We were just talking about him. I was just at Pirates. Skip's the man. He like really built that shit out of like nothing. It's pretty incredible what he did. And yeah, I worked for him forever, man. I got a Pirates Press tattoo, you know.
Oh, cool.
I'm the ink.
You're fam.
Yeah. So those guys are
you'll all... never question your loyalty.
No. Yeah, I love those guys.
Let me see that thing. That's chill.
Yeah. It's a real sailor-y tattoo.
Nice.
Yeah, man. They're awesome. And like, I think everyone's just kind of trying. I mean, Carl included, it's like everyone's just trying to get in where they fit in, you know? Everybody's got their own thing. And
it's a pretty profitable situation, being in charge of a plant. I mean, I kind of wonder, because
I wouldn't say it's in charge, but I mean, it's like, yeah, that's your business, is manufacturing. It's great though. I mean, they've been smart in terms of making new presses rather than scrambling after the old ones, because I've seen some of these old presses and they are really old. You should just build a new one.
Yeah,
you know. But I don't know if William Onyebor, you know that guy? He's incredible. Nigerian musician and super reclusive now because he's like born again. But David Byrne and his label were trying to get him to let them release this, like all his records for like 10 years. It took him forever because he's just like super adamant. He doesn't want to be a singer anymore. And he's like, I've turned to God, like all that stuff. Like he refuses to talk about any of it and like threw up all these obstacles. Like the booklet's like super thick. It's like a crazy, insane story about how this guy can't listen to his music anymore because it took him like a year to sign a contract. I don't know. Anyway, this incredible thing, but he was like such a like builder, man. He had like presses. He had like this whole like world-class studio and like pressing stuff. Like he like, it was like the he was like running a little fiefdom. Like he had this like fucking hit producing kingdom. And he's like always, he always had a cowboy hat on. He's all sorts of cool synths and stuff. Like a lot of old Elkas and Moogs and stuff. Really, really pretty awesome. You got to look him up.
Elka? I don't know. They mean Buchla?
No. Elka was like a Italian synth maker, and I feel like it was like maybe a generic brand.
So what's
for
this guy
else.
So William, Pirates is releasing it is
no,
got
no,
him
no.
to do something.
William Onyebor.
Yeah.
Okay, and the reason I was talking about him was because he had a pressing plant at his house here or whatever, you know. Like had a like compound where he was like recording the shit, pressing this stuff, just like massive, like his own distribution chain. It's pretty cool. I was wondering if anyone bought those from him since he's turned to God now and he's got all these presses.
Yeah.
And the world is hungry for
you
presses.
You said in Africa?
Yeah, he's in Nigeria, I think.
And most of the stuff that they do at Pirates is in the Czech Republic.
They work with GZ Media, which is like one of the older manufacturers. And they had record presses from like the 40s. They used to have like a whole bunch of them. And then, you know, vinyl sales dwindled and dwindled and dwindled. And they ended up with like a tenth of what they started with or something like that. But like punk and dance records, like, and, you know, kind of kept it going. You know, some like underground hip hop stuff. And like when we started, we were just like, I mean, as far as Pirates Press, like, you know, he had been working with them, this plant through another guy that did this recordpressing.com thing, but he's a jerk. Anyway, we both like worked for this guy at one point or another, but like essentially, yeah, it's just like a working relationship, because if you have a bunch of stuff that needs to go to the same place, like if you have a bunch of stuff that needs to go to the West Coast, it makes the most sense to ship it all together. The more that you ship together, you know, it's like essentially Eric just, you know, he just set up this relationship with them in which he had enough business coming in to make it worthwhile, you know, to do this once a week. And like get a big shipment, it goes out in the States, and like, you know, and it good working relationships too. It's like the industry was pretty non-user friendly. It was like the first friendly, like a pressing service, you know what I mean? So it's like,
there was definitely that, because a lot of the people that had been working in this industry like were clueless or old or just didn't know what the fuck at all. And so you're like, it was real scattershot. I mean, I think people have tightened up and like there's a bunch of young people working in the industry, and I'm not trying to disparage anyone, but at the time when, you know, we started doing it, it was like, I don't know. Yeah, people just didn't seem like to know what they were doing, and like,
yeah,
it's a bunch of weird old people.
Was it before? Was it like a business-minded, opportunistic sort of thing, or was it more like a niche thing, or like a?
We all wanted to eat. You know, it's like it's all of our jobs. You know, so it was always serious in that way.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
and the biggest sort of hurdle is the machines.
Well, no, I mean, not for them, because they had been maintaining those machines for 50 years. You know, they know how the stuff works. Their plant is incredible. All their stuff, like they're really smart. You know, they have a bunch of really good machinists. Like everybody's very, very professional. It's like different than what you'd kind of imagine in your mind. But like, yeah, I have nothing but the utmost respect for those guys. They've done some really cool stuff, and making new presses is. That's where it's at, man.
Is that what they're doing?
Yeah, they put, there was something in that article about how they're making new presses. I think I can talk about it. But yeah, I mean, I think that it's going to be important as we move forward if people really do like records. And I think that there definitely is a boom mentality going on, and a lot of people are making records that maybe shouldn't necessarily make records, because it like adds to a lot of the shit. I feel like a lot of these like promo things. I mean,
I don't know what you're talking about.
It is what it is, but I mean, I feel like there's a lot of like, you know, there's like pointless reissues, like the 17th reissue on vinyl of XYZ.
Right. You know? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Which is, I think that there's some boom mentality to it, but in essentially, like, I feel like the punk label model of like, we put, you know, we're manufacturing records because, you know, we know like 500 people are going to want this on vinyl, like, you know, not getting too ahead of yourself. And I feel like that is solid, even though that maybe the industry is kind of like blown up a little bit. And then like once it kind of settles in, like everyone's not going to be making like weird novelty shit to sell at Whole Foods, which I've seen. You know, it's like they have weird pressings of just whatever. I don't know. Mm-hmm. It's like, why is this brand new 180 gram and $26? Like, get out of here, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I, you know, maybe the industry is like in sort of a boomy mood.
Well, there's owning a label and manufacturing. I mean, there's two different mentalities.
That's true.
To do that successfully. Yeah. And it would start to get frustrating, I imagine, if you had to combine those.
Yeah, I did both. I did both for years, man. Everything's stressful. So you got to just kind of like choose your battles, you know?
Because you're like making the competition's records.
Yeah, I don't think of it that way, man. I mean,
on some level, I don't think of it that way either. But
yeah, I don't think so.
No, not like, even subconsciously.
Yeah, it's just like everybody's trying to do the same thing, man. We're always, the idea is like it doesn't have to be hard. We can make it look pretty cool. If fucking hiccups happen, we're not retards. We'll figure it out. You know, like. You know, there's so many things like that just get overlooked in general in terms of manufacturing. Like people, it's not like a user friendly layman, like anybody can do this sort of a thing. There's quite a lot of stuff involved, you know?
Yeah. Well, I just spent 6 weeks doing my artwork.
Yeah.
You had to hire two people and get the fucking PQ sheets from the mastering house and all this.
Those PQ sheets, they're pesky, man, but you need that shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, knowing how all this stuff goes together obviously was a good primer for like helping with the label. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. Some of these things, there's a sequence of events that happen. And even though every record is a unique snowflake, as I've said many times, essentially you're going through the same set of steps. So it's like, I'm a big list maker, and I just printed out like a lot of these lists. They're like, this is everything that you need to do for this release. And, you know, essentially like it pirates, you know, the order forms of the same idea, or like manufacturing something is the same idea. Though the components themselves change, you're still going through the same couple of steps. You know what I mean? And so it's like, if you list it out, you give yourself about the same set amount of time before you put it out, and you just like work on each thing like a couple steps at a time. I don't know. It's nice to kind of think of records, even though the records themselves couldn't be more different, you know, obviously artwork wise and like all that stuff, but essentially you need to jump through the same hoops. So why not?
Yeah.
Bang it out on a list.
Yeah, it must be, I don't know. It's like a big deal for me to just do it once. I mean, the whole process has taken years.
Yeah. The first one's usually the hardest.
Oh, well, that's good news. It's been really hard and expensive.
Yeah. I mean, it is an expensive process. And when shit goes wrong is the big thing. It's like you kind of have to like know where potential pitfalls are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was also doing it in a really sort of expensive way, as far as, I mean,
you like got like crazy lacquers cut and like did it like really pricey wise, you mean? Like you?
No, I did it in a studio and like a, well, it like, I did it at, it wasn't, you know, done in a practice space,
right,
and
right.
Mastered by someone I found on the internet or something.
Right.
It's like a pretty involved process. I mean, right after I hired one of the engineers, he was nominated for 2 Grammys.
Damn.
And
sounds sick.
So yeah, it was, so all that like was just a big fucking weight to have to maneuver through the process, especially for the first time, and not really just like, yeah.
Well, and if you're like
shot a little too high, maybe
if you're sitting in all the chairs at once for the first time for all the shit, like sometimes it's kind of easier if you work on someone else's thing first, or like you get your legs a little bit before you have to also be recording it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Cause like that's the end of one process, and then there's the whole other fucking process. You know what I mean? Like getting it from like one thing to the other is like, there's quite a lot of things that can go wrong and blah blah blah. Yeah.
Yeah. And you can even finish and then not enough money to tour it or do PR, all this shit.
PR is really expensive too.
And it just gets to sit in your storage space for PR is expensive, and it's,
you
wanna, I hate it.
You're getting the
No, it's kind of warm actually. It's kind of nice.
It'll give you a tan.
So like, but most of your day-to-day stuff is, I assume, just fulfillment?
No, I mean, it's all sorts of stuff, man. It's kind of like managing, pushing releases along, as far as like, you know, getting like layouts together. I do a lot of that. I do a lot of like the design, or sort of like bridging the gap design work. You know, order forms, production, you know, managing ship dates and fulfillment for like different distro stuff.
Yeah. What do you guys do for distribution? If you don't mind asking, you
have Revolver like- actually distributes all of our stuff, but, we have a European mail order. Our buddy at Forte does our European mail order, which is pretty sweet. So I always, you know.
So you don't have brick and mortar in Europe?
No. No. We don't really have brick and mortar here because it's, you know, I'm running it out of my house. It's not like, you know, someone, I think brick and mortar is usually, you're like, it's a store and you can buy stuff there, you know.
Well, yeah, I guess there's not that.
Yeah.
I don't know enough about it to really speak on it, but yeah. I don't know that much about Revolver, but I know companies like Orchard and some of these other distributors that the indie label, well,
yeah,
if there's such a thing as like whatever, like Matador or whatever, like we'll use the Orchard, and then they'll put it in your Hot Topic if you need it there or whatever.
Yeah. I mean, I've worked with them. I've worked with a couple other people. I don't want to say anything necessarily about them, but I think and I don't know if we've been talking about this already, but you know, the digital distribution model is seriously flawed.
Yeah.
And I think it needs a lot of work.
How so? I mean, because I haven't really worried about it too much, but it's not.
Yeah.
I'm not happy with it. I'm not with TuneCore.
I just think philosophically streaming is like underpaying. They're underpaying everyone. Each of these services is like, I just think it's stupid, man. The way I think about it is it should at least pay you an integer. It has to be a number. 1 cent.
Yeah.
1 cent per play is something that you can get your fucking head around. So that's kind of where I'm at with that. Like, I think that they're underpaying everybody, and that I think everyone, by cooperating with it, is underselling themselves and their future selves and fucking their grandkids' bands. I mean, if you want to think about it that way. But why completely undersell something like that? I mean, you're talking about like a factor of, it's 0.04 cents a play is the number that I remember, and I think it was for Spotify. 0.04 cents a play means that, you know, you have to, I mean, how many thousands of plays do you have to get for like a dollar? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's ludicrously small. And what the thousands of plays, I mean, it's not easy to just like manufacture that. It's like if you succeed even modestly there's no financial reason to do it.
No, I think if you get a million hits on YouTube, you get about $200.
Yeah. Wow. There's the fucking jackpot. And it's like, it's exposure. No, this is stupid. Everyone, I wish that everyone was just like, fuck it. I'm not going to do this. You can have crappy music up there. Go ahead, whatever. I mean, if, you know, Riri's new singles up there, like, I don't care.
Yeah.
But like, I think that anyone that's running their own stuff or like that has any sort of like self togetherness about this shit should see that that is far too little to give something. You can give something away and it's free. You know what I mean? Like, I believe in like, putting stuff up for free. That's totally cool. Tell people about it. And you know, that can be a thing, but you have control over it. You can take it down. You know, it's like if people put it back up, yeah, I guess, whatever. It's like YouTube's kind of another thing too, but like the streaming thing, I feel like is just giving it away. You know what I mean? It's like, they're like, okay, we can use this to make just shit tons of money for ourselves, and we're going to pay you something so laughably small.
It's not even a penny.
It's not even a penny. A penny a play is like, I think that's as low as anyone should go. It should be 5 pennies a play. It doesn't fucking matter to them. They're getting God knows how many subscriptions, and all they have to do is keep adding to their servers. They already wrote the fucking code. It's like, it's done, man. Mm-hmm. It's simple technology. It's not hard to do this stuff. Like, they're completely, completely missing the point. And like,
does it matter to you and someone who works in vinyl?
It matters to me because,
or like, to the artists on the.
It matters to me for the artists. Like, yeah, like, I'm concerned about, like, you know, how people's sales are doing for them, because like, I want to be able to send them money and be like, this record made money. Here you go.
Yeah.
And well, the digital stuff is it's laughably small.
In a lot of ways, I feel like at least the sort of garage rock, like DIY aesthetic is not really the type of people who would complain about it.
Yeah.
As much.
Yeah.
Or even care. Cause like,
yeah, so. I mean, it's possible. I mean, everyone's lazy, so it's like that's what they have going for them, is that everybody's lazy and doesn't really give a shit. And if it's convenient, they're like, oh wow, this is actually pretty cool. I'll pay $10 for this, and it's like, you know, like the fuck.
Yeah,
and users aren't going to make the change. The people that are giving up the content digitally should be able to say, no, I want more. I think that that's fucking totally reasonable, because when you think about a song that maybe costs thousands of dollars to make, a lot of songs do, when you do the math, I mean, it's crazy. It's crazy how much money you have to put into something, as you know, from doing this project, and the things got expensive. It's like, those aren't even always the worst cases. You know what I mean? Like sometimes that shit all works itself out in the wash. But when it comes out, when it comes down to it, you have something that you've paid like thousands of dollars to perfect on the low side sometimes. On the high side sometimes too. I mean, it can be, you know, everyone has different processes, but like, it's just selling yourself too short, man. You're worth more than that.
So what
if someone doesn't want to pay a penny to fucking listen to for this thing to be played?
Yeah,
like, come on, man.
Yeah, I mean,
is that gonna break your weird little fucking technology thing? I'm sorry, you can't have my fucking songs. Like that should be the conversation, but nobody's having it.
Well, I think a lot of artists that are in that sort of position can, you know, survive selling just physical copies themselves and take everything off streaming. There's certain artists that I know of right now who do that and tour and just don't play anymore.
Yeah.
Just don't play the internet game.
Yeah. Well, you got to play it in some ways, man, because obviously iTunes is the biggest fish in the fucking fryer, but like, what can you do? I don't know. It's such a fucking pittance that it kind of seems like it just seems to me like even looking at like records that have been successful, like, I don't know, man. I feel like we have good digital distribution. Like, it's getting out there. I'm seeing that it's being played a lot, but there's nothing. I mean, it's like crickets, nothing. We probably make more fucking money off CDs. Nobody buys CDs. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's like, why?
I wanted to ask you about, because I used to work at, how I got involved in music in the city was working at Hyde Street in the TL. And one of the people who keeps coming up is Eric Brower.
Eric Bauer.
Bauer.
Bauer. Bauer's
name. They did a lot.
He's really good.
You guys did a lot of your, the Castleface stuff there. Mm-hmm. And it seems like it's all really, it just has a really cool aesthetic about it. And like the studios. It's like right in the middle of downtown. I'd like to see it sometime.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Really say what's up, or maybe.
Yeah, for sure. We did like 1/3 of a Blasted Canyons record there.
Yeah.
We recorded like, a third of it in Portland with a buddy of mine, and then a third of it there, and then a third of it with Matt Hartman in the city. But there's a bunch of great engineers, man. Woodhouse is awesome too. I'm really looking forward to working with him. Because we're doing another male gaze record in October. So,
where's that?
It's in Sacramento. He's at it used to be the Hangar, and now it's called the Ramp. They like split it up. So there's the Ramp that's in Sacramento, kind of it's not really close, but close to where the other one was. And then they have this crazy one. It's like Stinson Beach, maybe, like one of these beaches, like kind of north, like northern or north on the one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember which one or what it's called, but it's like incredible. It's like this crazy, like Beetlejuice looking house with like all this great shit in it. There's like this really cool, I mean, I'm sure it was expensive, but like, I think that's what it is. It's just like pricey, but you're like looking down on a fucking like beach that's like super incredible. You're up on this mountain. It's really crazy.
Cool. Have you ever been to... like Prairie Sun's up there. It's one of my favorite places.
Prairie Sun is really pretty awesome too. I haven't been there since I was a kid, probably like 18 or 19.
Really?
Yeah.
What were you doing there then?
I recorded there once. I think we did like one song for a comp, just like in studio setup, kind of do the one song. And
yeah.
Then, which is cool. It was, I think that's what that was. For the, I'm blanking on the name of the comp. Anyway. This is when I was in the Life in Braille.
Where else you like to play aside from Hemlock? Like, what's your favorite? You guys,
I don't know.
Were you here for that chapel show, the OC's thing? Did you come up for that?
I came up for one of them. I got to see the first one. It was great.
Damn, I wanted to go. I went to and I had to go somewhere else to a different show.
Yeah. Well, they did it for 3 nights, but I got to see Useless Eaters and. I think the next night was Cold Beat, maybe. And then Feral Ohms, maybe, on the last night. And then Powell was playing, like, direct support the whole time. But, I got to see the Useless Eaters one. It was cool. It was a great show.
Yeah, I almost moved in with their drummer when I was like last year. I was really looking for a place to live.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I saw them play once at the chapel for with the Catalan or something, whatever the band is. But yeah, to be honest, I mean, I'm not like, I don't know. I can't, I have a hard time getting into garage rock.
Yeah.
And a hard time admitting that to people, especially in the Bay Area.
I mean, I don't know. I just like jams. I don't like to put too many labels on like what they are. Sometimes they're kind of garagey, I guess, but I don't know. Labels are labels. Like, I feel like we've been doing a bunch of shit that's like really out there, at least for Castleface too. Like this Apprentice Destroyer record that's coming out.
Mm-hmm.
Did I tell you about this? He recorded it all in a Guitar Center.
No.
It's an awesome record.
Really?
It's super cool, yeah.
There was a rapper who just did an album entirely in the Apple
Store, yeah. I heard about that after we had been working on this for a while. But it's kind of similar idea, but this shit's pretty, like, it's cool. It's really misanthropic. Kind of has like a black metal done on synths sort of density to it a little bit. But I don't know. It's really tough. It's kind of tough to describe, and it kind of goes all over the place. But it's a really awesome record.
Yeah, sounds like
pretty out there. Did you ever hear the Creeping Pink record that just came out?
Mm-mm.
That record's pretty awesome too. I mean, just like weird, sun-dappled kind of psychedelia. Kind of, I don't know. You know, it doesn't have to be a formula. But I don't know. We've just been kind of going like a lot of zigzags kind of stylistically, which is cool.
Yeah, how does that stuff, like, what's the process of working with an artist as far as putting up the money to have them do their, I mean, because that's basically what it is putting up the money to do to press the record and help, you know, support on like a tour, right?
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, at this point, it's kind of magic. I mean, I don't know.
It's magical?
It's magical, yeah. I mean, at this point, like, we've been doing it for a while, and so there's like catalog releases that have done well for a long time. It's kind of got like a life of its own, you know? So at first, like, it wasn't a bunch of releases all at once, but it's kind of like ramped up since then because it's kind of gotten a life of its own. But, you know, usually the process is just like, hey, we want to do this, and I don't know, work it out with the artist.
Yeah.
You know, it's mostly like, yeah, I don't know. We try and keep it like simple as much as possible. I know every time you say, I want to keep it simple, it's like you're complicating your life. But, you know, we just try and have good deals for bands and put good energy into stuff that, you know, you got to put the best foot forward. And it's nice to be in a position to be able to do that for other stuff and from like a lot of different vibes, a lot of different places. There's some really cool records coming up that we've been like working on and listening to a bunch. I'm stoked to see what people think because it's, you know, it's kind of all over the place, but I don't know. It's kind of like one of those, you know it if you see it sort of vibes.
Yeah,
like, oh, this is gonna work out.
Yeah,
I'm not really sure why, but this seems like it's gonna work out. I think that sort of a feeling has sort of guided the whole label thing.
How much involvement do you have with your artists? Say, I don't know, my buddy who I was talking to earlier, I was supposed to go help him move out of his apartment.
Oh no!
Oddly enough,
yeah,
but yeah, he was the bass player for one of the Castleface bands for a while. But I was just wondering, like, what, like, how much involvement do you have with them? Like, does it depend on the artist?
Whatever's necessary.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like you look at a situation, like, does this need anything?
Yeah.
You know, sometimes it's not super involved, but a lot of times it's been, you know, people that I've known for years, really good friends, like, there's all that too.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's really whatever's necessary. I kind of, you know, I'm sort of jack of all trades. It's kind of how I look at my position. It's like whatever is really needed. I kind of just try and like fill it out.
Mm-hmm. What involvement does like Brian Hughes have at this point? Because I think it was his like initial.
Oh, definitely.
When he helped us set it off.
He's always been a spiritual forebearer, and he's always got good ideas and like puts together cool shit. He's also super super busy, you know. He's a very successful commercial director, and he doesn't have the time to kind of like work on it in the capacity that I do. So, but you know, he was just doing some filming for us. He got together a crew for some shows that, and I think that's going to work out really well. So again, it's kind of like everybody is getting where you fit in. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
No, he's great. His shit is really cool. He did a POW video recently for, was it Here Comes the Spade? I think it was Here Comes the Spade. It's pretty cool. And I mean, he's just doing stuff all the time. He's an international man of mystery. I don't want to give up too many of his secrets.
Yeah, I wouldn't. I wouldn't want you to.
He's the man.
Yeah.
He's definitely the man. It's not a strict organization so much as you know, everybody kind of amoebas into whatever they need to be doing.
Yeah, that's how things that work happen.
Yeah, you know, somewhat improvised, but in general, I think it's like, it seems to be working out. Video, it's like you can, it's a huge difference if it's done right, you know?
Yeah, well, same thing with audio.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I lose patience with people with really low standards in both.
Oh man, totally. I agree. It's a look like anything else. You know? Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
I had like sort of more hi-fi.
Hi-fi aspirations.
Yeah. But I'm sure that'll change at some point.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of mid-fi, you know. It doesn't like have to be high or low.
Oh yeah,
it can be right down the middle.
What is that? What exactly?
Well, think about it, man. Mid-fi.
Huh.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be too grotty. I feel like just as much as there was a bunch of bands that maybe intentionally got too lo-fi, there was a bunch of bands right afterwards that I think intentionally got a little too hi-fi. And, you know, I think what you should be focusing on is the song and not like too much of the window dressing, you know? So I don't know. Maybe mid-fi is a good place to aim. Right in the middle. It's going for average, man. C+.
Yeah. Is there any shout outs you want to do? Shout out to Marijuana.
Shout out to my Mary Jane. No, not really.
Well, thanks for doing this, man.
Yeah, man, no problem.
Are we done?
We can be. Did you want to keep going? How long are we going?
Doesn't matter. All right, cool. Thanks, Matt.
You're welcome.
Matt's band is online at mailgazesf.com. You can find Castleface at castlefacerecords.com. This show, it's on iTunes. It's on Stitcher. It's at CameronAdair.com/podcast. If you have a minute, write a review on iTunes. Thanks.